Good evening and welcome to everyone to our second Yom Yerushalayim program. This is brought to you by the Bellows Matan Eshkolot program, an educator's program for in Tanakh studies. And Rabbanit Shani Taragin is the director, co-director, dean of students, Rivi Frankel. You'll be hearing from them soon. I just want 2 minutes to welcome everyone. Thank you for joining. Happy Mother's Day to those in the United States and anywhere else that you'll be celebrating Mother's Day. Shani, I'll tell you a bit more. We're very proud of the Eshkolot program. We have in our professional development track via Zoom, that's, you know, now we're all, everyone Zooming all around. We have students from Houston who's studying together with students from New York, Los Angeles. Thank you everyone from Los Angeles. I saw that Annie's here and a former Los Angeles educator, Dr. Ariella Agatstein. Welcome to both of you, Rivi, Shani, Rabbanit Shani. Welcome to everyone. And thank you so much for all the effort that you put into making this program. And I wanna say that we said Yom Yerushalayim will do the same program twice. No, how could we do the same program twice? There are two different aspects. This this time it also has to connect to Mother's Day. So it's those who were on last week's program, this is a totally new program connecting to the Yerushalayim and the mothers. And I was thinking about that. I'll leave you with one short thought. I was thinking, and Shani, Rivi, anyone take my challenge. I was thinking, was there a pasuk in the Tanakh where Yerushalayim is referred to as a mother? As an aim. And I was thinking, I took the concordance out. I didn't find it. What I did think of on my own, even because it's not the word aim, is something sad, but it is some kind of a connection where in Echa, right? We say Echa Yashva Badad. How did the city sit so, how did it sit so desolate? Ir Rabati Am. A city that had masses of people always in it, ke almana, right? Became as haitake almana, became a widow. So it's not the mother, but the a city being referred to as a widow. That's in pasuk aleph, and then in pasuk vav, vayetse mibat Zion. Yerushalayim is called the daughter of Zion, the daughter of Zion, of the specially marked city, Zion, but the daughter. So it's also, it's not a mother, but we're all on Mother's Day. We celebrate our mothers that we are daughters of. So it also has that connection of being called the but Zion. I don't remember. If someone can think of it or looks at the concordance, please, I'd love to know. What I did think of, that I became a mother in Yerushalayim for the first time. I was a young married, it was just my husband and myself. My mother couldn't come in, she was teaching, she was in the middle of her year, you couldn't take off then, you'd have to come, you'd come for a month. How could she take off a month from her teaching? It was in April. So Yerushalayim, in a sense, made me a mother and it became my mother. My neighbors would all help me, the tipat chalav, the hospital was so warm and nurturing and gave me instruction. My friends and relatives and Yerushalayim all became my mother. So happy Mother's Day. And we're gonna learn, we're gonna connect to Yerushalayim, to women, to mothers of Yisrael under the superb leadership and knowledge, the learning from Rabbanit Shani Taragin, Rivi Frankel, Annie Nagel, thank you, and also Dr. Ariella Agatstein. We look forward to a wonderful evening. Evening in Israel, afternoon, morning. Actually, it's 8 o'clock in the morning, I think, in Los Angeles. Thank you, everyone, for joining.
Rabbanit Malkavina, thank you. And this is a very special honor to be able to wish you in person Mazal Tov on the most prestigious award as Yikirat Yerushalayim. What better day? Mamash here in Yerushalayim now on Yom Yerushalayim to be able to share in the simcha of all, sisu et Yerushalayim v'giluba, even on the West Coast, on the East Coast of North America, everyone celebrating with you for all that you've contributed to Torat Yisrael in Yerushalayim. So thank you. And beautifully that you said that you're right. Yerushalayim is never described as a mother in Tanakh. But to share with you that in Yeshayahu Perek Nun Dalid, one of the haftarot, ironically of Nechama, of consolation, is Rani Akara Lo Yalada. We speak about right, Yerushalayim right. as a barren woman who has not, and the Parshanim explain, what does that mean? Akara Lo Yalada. Isn't that redundant? If she's barren, then of course she hasn't given birth. And Chazal explained, Rani Akara Od Lo Yalada. She has not yet given birth, but not to worry, because one day Yerushalayim will be that mother. She won't only be that married woman who is going to be in partnership with Am Yisrael and HaKadosh Baruch Hu. She is going to be that mother, and may we be zocha be'ezrat Hashem to see Yerushalayim in all its glory as a mother. And you're 100% right. What better day than Yom Yerushalayim, and at the same time on Mother's Day, to talk about the mothers of Tanakh who are connected to Yerushalayim. And Rivi can attest to my excitement at this theme. And initially I said, okay, we're going to speak about the mothers that we know so well in Tanakh. When we think about Eretz Yisrael, when we think about connections to Yerushalayim, we think of Rachel Imenu. And then the more that I thought about this, the more mothers came to mind. And therefore inspired, and I'd like to begin with the first part of a speech that was just delivered this past Yom HaTzma'ut. And this was really part of the inspiration for not just calling this the Mothers of the Land, but five mothers on the land that were celebrating on Yom Yerushalayim and on Mother's Day, delivered this past Yom HaZikaron on April 13th, again this year, Tafshin Pei Aleph, by Lieutenant General Aviv Kochavi. And please join me as we read this magnificent speech with which he began at the Kotel. This is an abridged version, and I'm only going to read the first part together with you. At the official ceremony at the Kotel that marks the beginning of Yom HaZikaron, the Chief of Staff, this is the Ramatkal of the IDF, Lieutenant General Aviv Kochavi, made a short speech entitled The Three Mothers, which was deeply moving and has already received praise throughout Israel. While the English here cannot really do justice to the speech, here is an abridged version of what he said. He began here by speaking about an unprecedented event, the journey home of the Jewish people to its land from all corners of the world. It's an unprecedented event in world history. We have to remind ourselves, he said, that it's a miracle, even though we now take Israel's existence for granted. But the story of our people and our land is also a story of individuals, young and old, fathers and mothers. And it is about three mothers. And we would like to argue tonight five mothers that we're going to speak about. And he began the way that we're going to begin, with Rachel Imenu, who did not merit to live in this land. She arrived at the land, but died immediately without meriting to live in it. When her children were exiled generations later, and they passed by her grave, Kol Berama Nishma Nihi Bechi Tamurim, Rachel Mebaka Al Baneha, a voice was heard in Ramah, a bitter and mournful cry, Rachel crying for her children. Her cry was heard, and the Navi Yirmiyahu tells of the promise, Min I Kolech Mibechi Ve'inayich Midima, Vishavu Banim Legvulam, stop your voice from crying and your eyes from tears. Your sons will return to the land. Rachel may not have lived in the land, but she was promised that her children will return to live in it. The majority of the life of our nation has been spent outside of our lands, outside of Yerushalayim, where we have been powerless and persecuted countless times. Zionism changed the situation fundamentally with incredible determination. And despite all the challenges, there began to return to Israel waves of Jews that formed the society and the state of Israel. We are those banim, those that have merited sheshavu legvulam, the sons of Rachel. And we're going to see of numerous Rachels and of Naomi who have returned to their land. We have returned to remain here forever. But the journey home has been bound up with an unbearable price. I'd now like to introduce Rivi Frankel, followed by Dr. Ariella Agatstein and Annie Nagel, who are going to introduce us as we visit sites connected to Rachel Imenu and Rachel Eshet Rabbi Akiva and Rachel Hamishoreret, the poetess Rachel, followed by Naomi, ending with not only Naomi, the grandmother of Malchut, but Naomi Shemer, to bring the stories of our mothers to life as we tour the land of Eretz Yisrael together, followed by a shiur to understand a little bit more about these mothers that have shown and paved the way for us as we return to our land and to Yerushalayim.
Hi, good evening or good morning to everybody. So as Shani so beautifully put it, how could we not start an evening of mothers and Yerushalayim talking about Rachel Imenu? And so what I'd like to do is to jump right in to the traditional site of the kever of Rachel right outside of Yerushalayim. Very, very familiar to a lot of people is this kikar, this traffic circle over here that the bus or the cars will let you off of, and you can park over here and then just walk down right into the tomb of Rachel Imenu. To tell us a little bit more about Rachel Imenu before we go inside and talk about her kever, I'd like to invite our current professional development fellow, Annie Nagel from LA, high school teacher of Tanakh in Yula for Girls, to share with us a few words about Rachel Imenu.
Hi, everyone. Thank you, Rivi, so much. I hope one day to Amir Tzashem soon be able to see Kever Rachel Imenu in person. It's a little tricky for those of us in LA to get there now. Thank you so much, Rabbi Chamani and Rabbi Malkabina for having this amazing Bellows Eshkolo program. It's truly been wonderful learning with everyone, even via Zoom this year. And I'm actually going to start by looking at Rachel Imenu, a quality of hers, sort of approaching it from a topic we discussed in Bellows Eshkolo, this idea of how do we make our learning relevant to our students? And one of our fellows, Olivia, actually wrote this great article this week about using pop culture to get us engaged in our learning and have our students engaged in our learning. So there's this idea in pop culture of the meet cute, which is sort of this funny encounter where a romantic relationship starts off. The guy meets the girl and it's a situation that's sort of interesting, and what happens from there? So Rachel Imenu's meet cute with Yaakov is one of the most famous in all of Tanakh, one of many that takes place by a be'er. And what we usually focus on in that meet cute is Yaakov crying and kissing Rachel. Most of the mafarshim focus on that. But when I was taking a closer look, thinking about Rachel Imenu, I noticed a description of her that I had not noticed before. If you look at the pasuk, it says, "Odenu medaberi mam," right? Yaakov was speaking with the other shepherds. "Verachel ba'a in hatzon." Rachel comes with the sheep. "Asher la'avia," her father's sheep. "Ki ro'ahi," because she was a shepherdess, right? And why does the pasuk need to tell us that she was a shepherdess? We know she came with the sheep, right? So it would sort of seem obvious, why is she a shepherdess? And the midrashim and the classical parshanim, they all sort of explain, why is it Rachel, right? She's a woman. Why not Leah, right? Ramban says it wasn't Leah because she was of marriageable age and it would have been inappropriate. It wasn't Leah because her eyes were weak. Svarno and Arachaim actually even say, ki ro'ahi, she was an expert in the ways of a shepherdess. But it becomes very obvious that the Torah is trying to tell us something by describing Rachel as a shepherdess. And this point becomes even more obvious because the Midrash and the Parshanim reference the only other female shepherdesses that we know of in Tanakh, the daughters of Yisro. But if you look at the pasuk there, it doesn't call them shepherdesses. It just tells us the action of what they were doing. They were bringing the sheep to drink, but they're not called ro'ot. Rachel is the only woman we know in Tanakh, ki ro'ahi. She is a shepherdess. And to sort of maybe understand what that means and what we're supposed to understand from that, perhaps we should take a look at the paradigm of a shepherd in Tanakh, who is famously Moshe Rabbeinu. And again, there's many famous midrashim that I'm sure everyone's familiar with, why Moshe was a ro'ah, either because he could have hisboded us with Hashem, and he took his sheep, you know, outside of the midbar so they wouldn't steal from, into the midbar so they wouldn't steal from the grass of other people. But what I think is the most sort of compelling midrash on Moshe being a shepherd is the Midrash tells a little story about Moshe Rabbeinu when Hashem first encounters him. The Midrash tells us that one of the sheep had run away from Moshe Rabbeinu. And instead of being all frustrated by that, he follows the sheep and he sees that the sheep is drinking from a little brecha, a little pool that the sheep found. And Moshe, again, instead of getting angry and frustrated that he had to run all the way from the other sheep, says, "Oh, poor sheep, you must have been thirsty." And he picks up the sheep and he puts the sheep on his back and carries him back because he was so thirsty and tired. Hashem sees this in the Midrash, according to the Midrash, and says, "You know what, Moshe? You take care of your little sheep like that. You can be the ro'eh for my flock, for Bnei Yisrael." What's the most important midah that Hashem wants to see from a ro'eh? Empathy. Caring. Even though it was hard for Moshe Rabbeinu to run after that sheep, he showed empathy. He showed caring. And just in case we weren't clear what the true midah of a ro'eh or a ro'ah in our case that we need to see, if we look in Yechezkel Lamed Daled, Yechezkel Lamed Daled is Hashem going after and chastising the leadership of Am Yisrael, the Malchei Yisrael. And who does he compare them to? What sort of flawed profession does he compare them to for not doing this profession properly? Shepherds. He says, "You are the Roi Yisrael, but you're the wrong kind of Roi Yisrael. Instead of taking care of the poor, you torture them, right? Instead of taking care of the weak, you ignore them." This lack of empathy, this lack of caring, that's the opposite of what a Ro'eh is supposed to be. A Ro'eh is someone who's supposed to show empathy, care. That is what it means to be a ro'eh or a ro'ah. And as Rabbanit Shani just referenced in that beautiful speech, right? We know that nobody embodies this more in Tanakh than Rachel Imenu. That famous midrash in Eicha, on the words that Rabbanit Shani, right? We hear a cry on high, Rachel mevaka albaneha, ki einenu, because they're not with her. And everybody, according to the midrash in Eicha, is trying to plead their case for Am Yisrael. All the avos. And Moshe, but who does Hashem listen to? Hashem listens to Rachel Imenu. Why does Hashem listen to Rachel Imenu according to the Midrash? Because she showed empathy for her sister Leah. And not just that she cared for her, she went out of her way. It was at a very large cost to her own happiness. She sacrificed her husband. She had to watch her sister give birth to child after child while she had none. So great was her empathy. Rav Shalom Shwadron points out the Maggid of Yerushalayim that Leah didn't even know about the sacrifice that Rachel made. That the fact that Rachel gave the simanim to Leah, as we famously know, according to Rav Shalom Shwadron, Leah didn't even know about that, right? Usually when we do something for someone, part of the way we can feel good about it is pointing it out and being like, "Yeah, I went out of my way. I hosted you for Shabbos, right? Like, I'm so great. I'm so awesome." You would think that at the very least, Rachel Imenu, right, would at least want to feel to Leah, "Look at the sacrifice I made for you. I gave you my husband," right? But if we look in the Pasuk, when it talks about many of Rachel and Leah's interaction, there's a famous interaction with the Dudaim, with the mandrakes of Reuven that he brings to his mother Leah. And when Rachel asks for some of them, Leah turns to her and goes, "It's not enough. You already took my husband?" And we're like, "What? Rachel gave you your husband." But it's clear that Rachel gave Leah her husband in such a way that Leah didn't even feel the kindness and the chesed that Rachel did for her. Such was the level of empathy that Rachel exhibited, that this aim of Klal Yisrael exhibited, that this ro'ah of Klal Yisrael exhibited. Such was the level of empathy that she showed for her sister. And that, Hashem says, is yesh sachar lefulaseich. That, Hashem says, is yesh tikva la'achariseich. And that's how we build Klal Yisrael. We're approaching Shavuos and we look at Megillas Rus, and I know we're going to get there with Naomi, but the bracha at the end of Megillas Rus that's given to Rus and Boaz is that they should build a house kileya kiracha ukileya asher benu shtehem as Beis Yisrael. This kind of empathy, where you can care about the other person, where you can look out for that sheep that wandered and thirsty, where you can give your husband to your sister without her even knowing. That's how we build Beis Yisrael together. That's how we unite. And perhaps that's why Hashem has Rachel as our mother along the way, as our ro'eh, as our shepherdess, waiting to bring us all back, to look out for us, to care for us. And I heard a beautiful idea just to conclude with the words that Rabbi Taragin started with. The pasuk in Yirmiyahu says, "Yesh sachar lefulaseich." There is a reward for your deeds, and there is hope for your end, right? So we would think there's reward for the fact that you gave Leah the simanim, that you were empathetic, and so therefore there's hope for your end. But I heard a beautiful idea that it wasn't sort of a tit for tat. Hashem saw the pi'ula, the actions of Rachel, the ro'ah in Rachel, the empathy, what she did for her sister. And he said, I see this, Hashem said, I see this midah of empathy, of being a true shepherdess, of looking out for everyone. And therefore, I know there's hope for Klal Yisrael. When we merit on Yom Yerushalayim and this Mother's Day to have that sort of empathy, that shepherd quality of looking out for each other, to bring us nechama for what we need and to really see a true, true geula where we can all be in Yerushalayim together following after the footsteps of Rachel Minina.
Amen. Wow. Thank you, Annie. That was really beautiful. Well said. I want to go back into Kever Rachel at this time and to continue on the themes that you were speaking about in terms of the chesed and the compassion and really how we can make this relevant to ourselves beyond our tefillot. Kever Rachel, I think, is one of the most beautiful places to come and daven. I often have students who say to me, you know, Rivi, you tell us that potentially Kever Rachel maybe was in a different space. Why should we come to this space and daven? And I tell them that regardless of the machloket about where Kever Rachel is, the thousands of years of Jewish tears, of Jewish mothers coming and crying for their children, b'schut Rachel Imenu, coming and taking on the idea of being more compassionate to their fellow people, b'schut Rachel Imenu, is really what makes the tefillot in this place powerful. In 2003, there was an unfortunate reason to make this site of Kever Rachel even more of a place to help us focus our tefillot. If you'll notice, here we are inside, and you can see there's a women's section over here. I don't ever get to see men's sections of these kfarim, so it's always really fun for me when I'm on Google Maps and like taking a look at the lar. I'm like, oh, and this, oh, I think our side has a little bit more room here, and like all of the different comparisons between the sides. But really what I want us to look at is this view that we have over here. So this would be the entrance of Kever Rachel, and here would be what is set up as her tombstone. But what I want to focus on is actually this parochet, this curtain hanging in the women's section. This is a parochet that was created from the dress of Nava Applebaum, a young woman, 20 years old, living here in Yerushalayim, who the day before her wedding was murdered along with her father and many others in the bombing of Cafe Hillel in 2003. And there was a decision made by her friends, really by her family, to hang her wedding dress here in Kever Rachel. Because in the same way that Rachel desired so much to have a family, to be able to pass on these midot of compassion, and yet when she came into Eretz Yisrael, she was not able to live in Eretz Yisrael and to raise that family. Nava's life was also taken too soon, too early, not allowing her the ability to raise a family in Eretz Yisrael. And so when we sit here at Kever Rachel, we think about the compassion of Rachel Imenu, and we daven in that schut, but we also daven in the schut of Nava for somebody who so badly and was so ready to build a bayit ne'aman b'Yisrael and didn't have that opportunity. And so we ask ourselves as we stand here, what do we do that mirrors that compassion? What do we do with the opportunities that we are given to be mothers and women and builders of Yerushalayim? I will give you a small example. Every time I drive on a new highway here in Israel, I sing the song, Ani Daniti Kvish, Be'eretz Yisrael, and my friends are all like, why are you so excited about building a road? I'm like, because I pay taxes. And while I don't want to pay taxes, I get with my taxes to build roads in Eretz Yisrael. How amazing is that? And then they all make fun of me more, and I continue singing, like when the new Begin was built. What a schut that we have to be able to be in Eretz Yisrael, to be able to build Eretz Yisrael. But what a loss we would have if we didn't take the lessons of the women that we're speaking about and build up our people, build up ourselves, build up our midot to be and have avodat Hashem here in Eretz Yisrael. Now we're talking about a number of Rachel Imenus, and what I'd like to do is actually jump to a Rachel who, while not mentioned in Tanakh, is definitely mentioned in our liturgy. And not just because of her famous husband. So this, of course, is Rachel Eshet Rabbi Akiva. And before we jump to her grave, her tombstone, where she's buried. I actually just wanted to show us where the kever of Rabbi Akiva is, because this is the more famous. I think most people in Tveria maybe have been either to the Rambam, which is right down here, or to kever Rabbi Akiva. And I actually have a beautiful picture taken at night. This is one of my favorite places to take groups when we have a little bit of time in Tveria. Of course, to daven by the burial place of Rabbi Akiva. And also there's a tradition that the Ramchal is buried there as well. But just look at the fantastic view that we have of the Kinneret. This is at night overlooking Tveria. And we of course have the mountains behind us, and down below we can see this is the kever, the traditional kever of the Ramchal. And here we have the kever of Rabbi Akiva into the mountain. And it really is just a beautiful, phenomenal sight. But a lesser known site that I also love taking people to if we have time in Tveria is a quiet, small kever just on the side of the Kinneret. And that is the kever of Rachel Eshet Rabbi Akiva. And it's interesting because most people, when I take them there, they've never heard that it was in Tveria. They've never heard that that's somewhere they can visit. And they often ask me, you know, why is this on our list of places when we're in Tveria that you're gonna take us to? Kever Rabbi Akiva, we understand the story of Rabbi Akiva, the view, but this small on the side of the Kinneret, really, why are you going to bring us here? So as we step inside to this very small and yet very modest little building, right outside the Kinneret over here, I'd like to invite Dr. Ariella Agatstein, who is an alumna of the third machzor of the Matan Bellows Eshkolot Fellowship, to share with us a little bit about the impressive life of Rachel Eshet Rabbi Akiva.
Thank you so much. First of all, I owe tremendous hakarat hatov to the Bellows Eshkolot program and to Matan, really for giving me such an incredible amount of knowledge and skills, and I am forever indebted. So thank you so much. So here we are, and we're at the kever of Rachel Eshet Rabbi Akiva. And today we're celebrating the strength of women, and we're realizing the shoulders upon who we stand. So who was Rachel? And so we know a lot of, you know, pieces. We'll review it very quickly, but I think there's a new angle, dafka on Mother's Day and dafka on Yom Yerushalayim. And so the story of Rachel, the wife of Rabbi Akiva, is one of the most magnificent depictions, in my opinion, of a woman in the Talmud. And so much of Rabbi Akiva and who he was influenced by Rachel and their love. And the Gemara in Kesubos, Daf Samech Dalet Amud Bet, relates that Rachel was the daughter, we know, of Kalba Savua. And we know his name was Kalba Savua because if you entered his home and you were like a kelev that was hungry, like a hungry dog, he was so wealthy that you left save, like the word savua, you left full. And Rachel was his only child, and she was going to inherit his fortune. And our rabbis teach us how, you know, she would have been, right, the greatest Talmidei Chachamim of her day would have been lucky to marry her, right? And yet, we know that she meets one of the shepherds of Kalba Savua, and we know his name is Akiva, which is the Aramaic version of Yaakov, and, you know, they fall in love, and she sees something so special in Akiva. And she tells him that she's going to marry him on condition that he go and learn Torah. And so the two secretly wed. And of course, we know when Kalba Savua finds out, he's very angry. He not only swears that Rachel will not inherit his fortune, but he kicks her and Akiva out of his home, and they're penniless. And we also see from here a tremendous strength of Rachel, that she stood up to what her father thought she needed in a husband, and she knew what she needed, and she went after it despite the hardship that it would cost her. And the Gemara in Nidarim, Daf Nun Amud Aleph, goes on to say that they were so poor, this couple, Rachel and Akiva, that they slept in a hut on straw, and even in the winter, and that other poorer people would come to them and ask for straw, and they happily would give of the only thing they had, which was straw. And Rabbi Akiva even said to Rachel, he said, we're so fortunate, at least we should be happy with what we have, at least we have straw to give to others. And lovingly, the Gemara tells us that he lovingly picked the straw out of his wife's hair. So they were definitely, as a couple, gomle chasadim, they certainly shared this a certain level of their values. And the Gemara continues and tells us that Rachel goes ahead and encourages Akiva to go to yeshiva. And he was 40 years old. He didn't know the Aleph Bet. And the Talmud tells us how he sat there in, you know, the cheder or whatever it is, learning the Aleph Bet with his son at the same time as his own child. Can you imagine what that must have been like? And yet Rachel encouraged him. And eventually he went to go learn with Rabbi Eliezer and Rabbi Yehoshua. And he started earning the reputation of becoming a rising star and having unparalleled brilliance. And Rachel encourages him to go away, and he's away for 12 years, the initial 12 years. Some try to personify Rachel as almost the wife in waiting, almost this tragic sort of person. But in truth, however, what Rachel had was anything but passive. It was anything but weakness. In fact, she was strong-willed. She knew what she needed. She was resourceful. She was a hard worker, supporting herself when Akiva wasn't home, with Rabbi Akiva wasn't home. And she also had an incredible gift. What was her gift? Rachel had the gift to see what yet did not come into fruition and to nurture that. It was the power to believe in someone before they even believe in themselves. It's the power of optimism. And we know Rabbi Akiva comes back after the 12 years and, you know, he overhears a neighbor talking to Rachel and trying to convince her that Rabbi Akiva was not worthy of Rachel and that he abandoned her, he abandoned his responsibilities as a husband. And let me tell you, Rachel tells him off and she says, you know what? I'm so proud of my husband that if he was up to me, he would go for another 12 years to learn in the Beit Midrash. And Rabbi Akiva overhears this and he knows that she's sincere. And so he goes back. Now, can you imagine that strength? This time when she said that he could go back, he should go back for 12 more years because she saw this potential in who he was. This time, this second group of 12, she knew what she was getting herself into. It wasn't like the first 12 where like she did it and maybe she, you know, one could say she, or may, could she maybe have regretted it? Maybe she saw she, you know, bit off more than she could chew. No, she said, go back again. And she knew what she was getting herself into. And we all know the famous story. Rabbi Akiva comes back after 12 more years, and this time he has 24,000 Talmidim, and he's, you know, every city that he goes through, everyone is coming out to meet this famed Rabbi Akiva. And she hears he's coming home, and although she's a penniless pauper, Rachel goes out to greet her husband, and she's so proud because all those years she envisioned who he could become. She saw his neshama when she met him originally, and she knew this man has the potential to become so great. And now here he was, 24,000 Talmidim. And as she is approaching him, they see this woman. They don't know that she is his wife, and they try to push her away. Now, of course, we know later on, unfortunately, the 24,000 Talmidim of Rabbi Akiva, lo nahagu kavo zebazeh, we know that story. Unfortunately, they died all during a plague. Rabbi Akiva, however, sees Rachel approaching him, and he pushes aside his Talmidim, and he takes out a chair, and he has her sit on the chair, and he says, Sheli v'shelachem shelahi, everything that I am and everything that you have is because of this woman. The Avot Rabbi Natan even goes far enough to say that every poor person would be in Shamayim compared against Rabbi Akiva. How so? And what does this have to do with Rachel? In the fact that if a poor person does not learn Torah during their lifetime, in Shamayim, they'll say, well, Rabbi Akiva was poor and he learned Torah, to which the poor person in Shamayim after 120 years could say, but I also had children And I had to take care of my children. And in Shemayim, they could say, well, Rabbi Akiva had children and he was poor and he learned Torah. But at the end, says the Avot Rabbi Natan, really, the answer of the poor people is something unique. And the answer, Mipnei Shezachta Rachel Ishto, but maybe he was able to do all those things because he had Rachel as his wife. So we see Rachel emerging as this heroine behind Rabbi Akiva. And it's her ability that she was able to believe in what was not yet there, right? And it reminds me of this story. And it's a story written in a book that is not Jewish, right? The book, it's called Seven Habits of Highly Effective People. It's a great book if anybody ever reads it. It's written by Stephen Covey. And in one of the first chapters, he talks about this idea of believing in someone. And he talks about his son, and his son was a terrible football player. And him and his wife would go to the games. And like from the sidelines, when their son was doing terribly, him and his wife would say like, yay, you can do it. Like, we have faith in you. Yay, we know you'll do a great job. The truth is they didn't really believe it. And their child was looking at them and he wasn't improving in any way. And one day, Stephen Covey and his wife went home and they said, you know what? We're getting lip service that we believe in him. But the truth is, we don't believe in him. The truth is, what we need to do is believe in him. And they had to go through what he calls this paradigm shift of, if we say that we believe in you, we have to believe in you. And I think to that point, basically, I'll tell you the end of the story. The end of the story is they changed their paradigm. And they started believing in their son. And when they cheered him on, their son could feel it. And he tells how their son got a football scholarship to college because of the power of that paradigm shift of truly making yourself believe in your child. What's interesting is that Rachel had this power. She saw Rabbi Akiva and she wasn't just giving him lip service. Oh yeah, you'll become a Talmid Chacham. Okay. She really had faith in him. And by the way, Rabbi Akiva and Rachel, the Gemara tells us that their daughter married Ben Azai, who became a huge Talmid Chacham, but who also started off as a very simple Jew. She too saw this idea of believing in someone. And this idea, this optimism is something that truly shaped Rabbi Akiva. And we know Rabbi Akiva was shaped by the love of Rachel. Perhaps that's why we know that he is the one to say, V'ahavta l'reacha kamucha, ze klal gadol batorah, you should love your fellow man. Perhaps he was shaped by the love of his wife. And maybe that's why the last scene of his life, as he's being tortured, he says, now I understand what it is to love Hashem with all your heart and all your soul. He was shaped by that love of his wife. And maybe it seems he was also shaped by that optimism. And that's why when all of his colleagues saw the Beit HaMikdash destroyed and they were crying, Rabbi Akiva had the optimism to see what was not yet there, to know one day I see that the Mikdash is going to be rebuilt. And maybe some of that optimism came from his wife, Rachel. And maybe perhaps he also had some misguided optimism in his belief in Bar Kokhba as the Mashiach, right? In this person who he believed maybe, right? But maybe perhaps that was even taking his optimism just a little too far. And I want to end with the following quotation. Rabbi Meir Soloveitchik says, this then was Rabbi Akiva's message to the Jewish people, a message that allowed them to endure an almost incomprehensible assault on their faith. Through the sustaining power of love, anything can be overcome. And to add to that, not just love, but Rabbi Jonathan Sachs Zatzal also said something also on these lines, and Rabbi Meir Soloveitchik also quotes it. And he says this idea of hope that Rachel had, hope in her husband. And by the way, before I tell you the words of Rabbi Sachs, this doesn't just mean having faith in a spouse. It's having faith in your friends when you're giving them advice, when you're saying you're going to be okay. It's having faith that they're going to be okay. It's having faith in a child. It's having really faith in a student. And it's also appreciating the faith that others, like our mothers, had in us. And I'll say two more things. So Rabbi Jonathan Sachs Zatzal says, hope is not a mere instinct. It is born in faith, the faith that Hashem exists, that he keeps his promises and he forgives. A people that never loses hope cannot be defeated. The Jewish people kept hope alive. Hope kept the Jewish people alive. And it's not just Rabbi Akiva's hope, but where did he get that hope from, says Rabbi Jonathan Sachs? It's also from his wife, Rachel. And today, as we are celebrating Yom Yerushalayim, we remember Rachel. I want to tell you something. After the story of Rachel and Rabbi Akiva finishes and Kavah Savua, we know he says, I'm sorry, he undoes his vow, and Rachel gets his inheritance. Rabbi Akiva, the Gemara says, gives her a crown of Yerushalayim Shel Zahav. And maybe he gave her a crown. Maybe it's because of all of the crowns of the letters in the Torah that he was able to darshan because of her. We'll never know. But that idea of hope and of optimism. And as we look, I'm right now in Yerushalayim. And we are so thankful that Yerushalayim is under Jewish control. And yet today, as we are reminded of hope and as we are reminded of our faith in each other and the faith that our mothers perhaps had in us, certainly my mother had a lot of faith in me before I even had faith in my own self. We are also filled with hope for Yerushalayim, that also one day we will see the ultimate redemption and the building of the Mikdash here. Thank you. Chag Sameach.
Amen. Thank you so much, Ariella. That was so beautiful. And you tied in so well, so much of where I'm going. It's almost like we discussed it beforehand. We did, but not to this degree. It's amazing. So as we leave the area of the grave of Rachel, Eshet Rabbi Akiva, we're going to take a look just inside the actual, where the tomb has been set up as a memorial. Hold on. Oh, okay. One second. We're going to go back one, just so you can see inside the actual kever itself. So here we have a very beautiful dedication to Rachel, Eshet Rabbi Akiva. You can see in the past couple of years, they've really redone it. The first time I came here, you know, everybody goes to the kever of Meir Bala Nes, the student of Rabbi Akiva, who's so close by, and this had kind of fallen in disrepair. And now we see that they've really taken a lot of care to rebuild it. Ariella spoke a lot about hope and about seeing potential where perhaps others didn't have the ability to see what could be. And I think that's such a great introduction to the next Rachel that we're going to talk about and the last Rachel of our evening, and that's Rachel the poetess. So Rachel the poetess, and here you can see a picture, her name was Rachel Blaustein. She was born in Russia, she grew up in Ukraine. She died relatively early, around the age of 40 in 1931. And so if we're talking again also about the Ramchal was buried next to Rabbi Akiva, and people suggest that he was the Gilgul of Rabbi Akiva in order to accomplish all the Torah learning that he could not do in his first 40 years. So here we have another young person who really accomplished so much in such a short amount of time. She was an accomplished writer. She spoke many, many languages, and she comes to what is Israel, the Eretz Israel, but not quite yet the state of Israel, in the early 1900s. And at first she's living in Rehovot with her family, and then she moves to the Kfutzat HaKinaret area, right on top of Degania, which we will go back to in a second. I just want to show you that recently, Rachel, who really has been coined the mother of modern poetry here in Eretz Yisrael, was put on the 20 shekel bill as a tribute to the effort that she made and the impact that she made on modern Israel. Now, the thing about Rachel that's really, I think, fascinating and connects her so strongly to Rachel Eshet Rabbi Akiva was her ability to see something and beauty where others were not able to. So here we see she died of tuberculosis, and unfortunately, she got stuck in Europe when she was studying painting and was not able to come back to the land of Israel until 1919 at the end of World War I. And she kept yearning and saying, I want to go back to Israel. I want to go back to Israel. And she was unable to. And while she was in Russia, because she was able to leave from Europe to Russia, she ends up contracting tuberculosis, which at the time was a death sentence. And not only was it a death sentence, but it was highly, highly contagious. And so the children that Rachel originally learned Hebrew from, and then she dedicated her life to teaching here in the land of Israel, she was no longer able to be in contact with them for fear that she might spread the disease. And so she wanders. She wanders around Israel. She lives in Yerushalayim for a short period of time. Then she lives in Tel Aviv. And eventually she's asked to be buried here in the place that she first makes her home. And we can just see how beautiful this place really is, right on the south border, the southwest border of the Kinneret. I'd like to share two poems that Rachel wrote, one of which I think really gives us an idea of that hope for potential, of seeing something that in her mind's eye is so clearly developed. And yet if we were to look at that same picture, we might think to ourselves, really, this is what she's talking about? I apologize that I don't have a digital copy of this, so I'm going to read it to you from my hard copy. The poorer the food, the gayer the young people's voices. We were afraid of welfare. We were drawn closer to sacrifice, to torture, to prisoners' chains, which would allow us to bravely sanctify the name of our homeland. I remember we planted eucalyptus trees in a swamp where the Jordan River leaves the Kinneret and runs southward to the Negev, foaming on the rocks, flooding its banks. More than one of us trembled with fever afterwards on a thin bed, but not one of us, not even for a moment, ever losing the feeling of thankfulness for our fate. We labored out of soulfulness. The thirst was racking. One of us would enter the water with our favorite container, a tin can once used for kerosene. What a pleasure it was to reach down toward the gravel of the shore and to drink endlessly, like a forest creature, to immerse one's burning face into the water, stop to take a breath of air, and once again, to drink until exhaustion. It is said this water has wondrous properties. Whoever has drunk it will return. Is this why the young men abroad long for the quiet shores of the Kinneret, because their ancestors quenched thirst here? On the Shabbat, I used to set out for rest in the nearby hills. So many twisting crevices, so many deer hiding places, so many green riverbeds. If only I could remain here all my life. It is good to walk down the path around the shore until one sees the walls of the city and its round towers. Tiberias is ancient. It does not look like a city to me, but rather a drawing in a schoolbook about the distant past. Look, these stones saw the pale faces of the preacher of Nazareth. He heard the oral law of the rabbinical sages. And these gray stones even remember the face of beautiful Veronica. The Kinneret is not a simple landscape, not just a part of nature. The fate of a people is contained in its name. Our past peeks out of it to watch us with thousands of eyes, with thousands of mouths, it communicates with our hearts. And yet this exact same landscape, when it was seen by Mark Twain, was described as desolate, that not even the cactus or the tumbleweed, friends of a fast soil, could make their homes in this land. So what did Rachel see? Rachel saw the potential, the yearning, the ability to throw oneself and to work into something that was an inheritance for us. As opposed to Mark Twain, who didn't see that potential. Same landscape, two different eyes. There's one other piece I would like to read. And in Hebrew, it's called Hatishma Koli. It was brought really back into the eye of the public after Ilan Ramon died on his re-entry into Earth, coming back from his trip into space. Do you hear me? Who are you? So far away from me, my dear. Do you hear me crying aloud, wishing you were well, wishing you were near? The world is vast, its ways diverse, brief meetings, parting longing, partings long, men with unsure feet post on never to return, too weak to find the treasure they have lost. My last day drawing near, of the tears of separation, I will wait until you, my life leaves, as Rachel did her beloved. And in the same way that Rachel the poetess draws on her namesake of Rachel the past, in the same way that she shares that vision of Rachel, of hope and rebuilding of Rachel Eshet Rabbi Akiva, there was another woman who was inspired by Rachel the poetess. This time, that woman was not named Rachel, but rather Naomi Shemer. Naomi Shemer was born just a year before Rachel the poetess dies, and she was actually born in Kfutzat HaKinneret, the kibbutz that was so dear to Rachel the poetess. And when Naomi Shemer dies, she asks to be buried in the same cemetery as Rachel the poetess. And so here we see, unfortunately, with the Google images, you can't actually see that Rachel's tomb is right over here, but you can see that same view. And here we have the tomb of Naomi Shemer. Despite the fact that she had no longer lived in the kibbutz that she grew up in, she was inspired by this voice, by this vision, by this using of words to inspire a nation, a would-be prophet of the modern people, if you will, using the rhetoric, not just of the past, but also of their vision, to be able to inspire a generation, to move a generation, to come closer to Yerushalayim and ultimately to God. And so it's Naomi Shemer who we are going to end with as our mothers of inspiration for the evening. Naomi Shemer, whose voice through the song of Yerushalayim Shel Zahav is the anthem of today. And what I would like to do is play for you Yerushalayim Shel Zahav, one of the most beautiful versions that I've ever heard. And I'd like us in our tour portion to end by looking at the Kotel on the celebration of Yom Yerushalayim, the day when we were able, after 19 long years, I'm actually in the middle of reading Rav Gorin's autobiography, where he talks about all the different ways he tried to get to the Kotel and he couldn't because it wasn't meant to be. But after 19 years, Har Bayit Biyadenu, Temple Mount is in our hands, Yerushalayim Shel Zahav is once again a whole crown.
Avir harim tzkayayim ve'achoranim Nisav ruach ha'arbaim im kol ha'amonim Ulkar damak ilan ba'ev shuya Ha'ir asher badad yushev u'eliva choma Yerushalayim shel zahav shel nechoshed shelo
I could honestly sit and listen and watch and be at the Kotel for a very long time. But at this point in the program, I would like to turn the stage, the mic, the Zoom camera over to Rabbanit Shani to continue with her shiur on tying all of these beautiful elements together. But before I do that, I'd like to echo the words of Annie and also, of course, of Ariella, that the zchut that I had to be a student at the Matan Bellows Eshkolot Institute for Tanakh Teacher Training, and the zchut that I had to not just come after a long line of legacies of amazing mothers of Am Yisrael, but to learn Torah from people like Rabbanit Shani and Rabbanit Malkabina, and of course, Dr. Brian Yochavid Levy, who is not here with us this evening, but is a huge impact on the program. And so I thank the Bellows and I thank Matan, and I really thank all of you for coming and being a part of the Torah that we are learning and that we are able to share and that we can inspire ourselves to continue in this journey of searching for what is shalem, what is wholeness, and bringing a little bit more of our voice and the voice of Yerushalayim into the halls of the Beit Midrash. So, Shani, thank you so much, and everybody for being here. Thank you.
Rivi, thank you. And Annie and Ariella, that was truly magnificent. And there's no greater zchut, as Chazal teach us, mikom olam dahiskalti v'chaberai yoter mirabotai. Or in this case, Tamidotai Yoter Mikulan. What a tremendous chut. And I'd also like to thank the Bellows, together with Dr. Brian Yochavid Levy, and certainly our Yekirat Yerushalayim, Rabbanit Malkabina, for providing this opportunity, not only of learning with, but ultimately learning from one's own students through at the Bellows Eshkolot program. And without further ado, to incorporate so much of what they've taught us this evening and tying all of our mothers together, the mothers of Eretz Yisrael, the mothers who in fact inspire us, as we look tonight at our five mothers on Mother's Day on Yom Yerushalayim, longing and laughing together with them, trying to seek the messages of our three Rachel Imenus and our two Naomis, the five mothers of the land. So we're going to begin
just as Annie did beautifully. And now that you have the picture of Kever Rachel and a little bit of the meaning behind Rachel Imenu not being buried together with the rest of the patriarchs and matriarchs, but rather on her own with a promise of one day, Vishabu Banim L'Gvulam, what that really teaches us. So Rachel, interestingly, is actually called the mother at the crossroads. More than any of the other matriarchs, she is Mama Rachel. She's the mother, the Eim HaDerech, which literally means the Tzomet, a juncture, because Rachel Imenu is one who is always vacillating. She's always straddling between, on one hand, as we see, her understanding of Elohim, of the general guidance of God in this world, the natural providence, and Yosef Hashemli, and her appreciation of Hashem's deep involvement in her life. And that's why, on one hand, she is seeking after Dudaim, the mandrakes. She comes and demands of Yaakov as well, Hava libanim v'mayin metanuchi, that she realizes, Yosef Hashem libanachir, that the only way that she's ever going to merit having another child is if she appreciates Hashem's involvement. Yosef, therefore, represents for generations to come God's involvement in life. As Yosef himself is going to tell the brothers, do you think, Hatachat Elokim Ani, do you think that everything can be explained through the sail down to Egypt, my survival, my success, my ensuring the economic survival of Am Yisrael clearly is from God. And therefore, when it comes to Rachel stealing the trafim of her father, Lavan, Chazal explained to us, albeit Rashi says, she wanted to rid her father of idolatrous practices. But even Ezra says, if that's the case, she really should have buried them. Apparently, she's still straddling. She still does attribute some forces to these trafim, which can be seen in the Israel Museum. These pregnant idols of different animals, which she places, as we know, while she is menstruating, she places them under the karit of her gamal, basically saying, I hope maybe these forces of nature will enable me to conceive again. Or as the Ramban says, she believed that they had some power of fortune telling, of being able to anticipate the future. And she was afraid that her father would use it to find out where Yaakov had run away to. Whatever the case may be, we know that it's going to be these trafim that she says are the source of her death. After all, Yaakov says, whoever has the trafim is going to die. And while when she first comes into the land of Israel and they pass through the areas of Beit El, and Rachel is going to be in a state of dying, the Mialit, it says, don't worry, it is a ben. The initial cries then of Rachel are found by Beit El when she first comes to the land of Israel. A little bit of tikkun as she names her son Ben Oni, that Rashi explains is Ben Sa'ari, the son of my pain. And Rashi says that Yaakov is going to rename him Benjamin, the son of Eretz Yisrael, the son of the south, the son of the land of Canaan that we're going to right now, back to my father's home. But if we look at Ben Oni and Sefer Shmuel and Zechariah, we see that the same word of oven is associated once again with trafim. She realizes that she's dying because she put too much trust in these natural forces and not enough trust in HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And Yaakov says, no, you're not dying because of your sin. You're dying because of my yamin, because of my right hand, because of my oath. And each one takes responsibility for the death of Rachel. The death of Rachel that we're going to see represents not only a short-term tikkun, but she becomes our mother. Because in fact, we all inherit a little bit of, on one hand, her long-term anticipation. As Annie explained beautifully, we all have inherited a little bit of her empathy, the empathy that we hope one day will bring us back for good to the land of Israel. And Rashi teaches us that when Yaakov explains to Yosef that he had to bury her on the way and he didn't take her all the way to Hebron, he says, because I anticipated that Rachel is going to serve literally as the tamrur. She is going to serve as the guiding light, as the traffic light for Am Yisrael. She's going to guide us when we go into exile. She's going to understand that tension that we always have, the dialectic between Elohim and Yud Kei Vav Kei, the natural explanations of politics and economics versus the divine hand of God. She's going to be the one to tell us, no, now's the time. It's not just because of a UN resolution. This is the time that HaKadosh Baruch Hu wants for us to return. And Rashi therefore quotes the famous psukim from Yirmiyahu Perek Lamed Aleph, Kol Beraman Nishma, The voice is heard from Ramah, directly north of Beit El. Nihi b'chit hamurim, Rachel mivaka al baneha. Rachel, more than any other mother, is crying for her children. Me'ana lihinachem, just like Yaakov, refused to be consoled when he thought that Yosef was dead. So too, Rachel refuses to be consoled. She is the most tenacious of the mothers. She is the most persistent. Because her children aren't there. And basically, as Ami described beautifully, the famous midrash that says, God, can't you have some rachamim on your children? Look at my mesirut nefesh. Look what I forfeited to my own sister. And a relationship with a sister is not the same between a parent and a child. Can't you have rachamim for Am Yisrael? Can't you see that even though they didn't necessarily fulfill all of your dreams, my dreams weren't fulfilled, and I had rachamim on my sister, can you have rachamim on Am Yisrael? And Hashem answers, Kamar Hashem mini kolech mi bechi beinayach midima, ki es sachar lepulatech v'yesh tekva lacharitech nim Hashem, v'shavu banim legvulam. And we see from here that there are two ways that Rachel Imenu is teaching us, that we can be returned to Eretz Yisrael. Ki es sachar lepulatech nim Hashem v'shavu me'eretz oyev. Sometimes because of oppression of an enemy, we're going to be forced to return to the land of Israel. After the Shoah, World War II, we don't have any other homeland, we come here. But then we fast forward a little more, 1967, to come back, not just because of world oppression, but because this is our home. These are our borders. Rashi tells us all the fathers, all the mothers stood up in front of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, but only when Rachel Imenu comes, only when she cries, only when she speaks about her commitment to her sister. Shemasarti lahasimanim. So Hashem, can't you have rachamim on Am Yisrael as well and bring us back? And Hashem says, yes. But interestingly, Rav Aviner explains, this isn't just talking about her deeds of the past. This is Bechi Tamurim. It's talking about her cries of the present, her persistent tears. It's that mesirut. It's going to be that commitment through which we're going to return. And it's specifically Rachel who then turns to Hashem and says, wait a second, God, again, I thought that a relationship between parents and children is not just about nature. You taught me that through the Dudaim. You taught me that through the Trafim. I thought that you're involved, just like you're involved in the conception of every child, you're involved in the success of every child and the salvation of every child. Hashem, where are you here? If it's just about deen, if it's just about the rules of nature, then you're right. Then Am Yisrael don't deserve to come back. They've sinned. But if it's about Yudke Vavke, it's about Rachamim, if it's about your personal involvement in our life, then where are you? And that's why Hashem answers, you're right. Everyone's going to come back. And even though Rachel is crying now for Shevet Yehuda, Hashem says they're all going to return. Because where is Rachel crying from? Eretz Binyamin. Rachel is crying for her children. Masha at mitpalelet ba'adam, yesh bazeh sachar yashuvu me'eretz oyev. Yesh tekvas is the malbim. Acharit ha'yamin. The eight kids at the right time, Rachel. You're going to come home. You're now at the crossroads. You're only in Beit Lechem. You're going to make it home. You're going to go to Hebron. And from Hebron, as we know, like David HaMelech, the next place is Yerushalayim. You're going to make it back. And we know that it wasn't just during the time of the initial destruction, or when Yirmiyahu quotes Perek Lamed Aleph, it's in the year 597 BCE. It's 11 years prior to the destruction of the Beit HaMikdash. Anna, we see. Anna, I'm checking the audio. As I take a look over here, is it a little better? Okay, I hope everyone can hear. Oh, and I realize, why not? Okay, sorry, one moment. Thank you. Okay, this should be much better.
Is that here? It's not only during the time of 597 BC, 11 years prior to the Korban, but let's fast forward 10 chapters in Yirmiyahu. We see that 10 chapters later, Yirmiyahu, in fact, speaks again to the people. Again, now we see that Yirmiyahu talks about those who had remained in Yerushalayim, the last of the exiles, the ones who are going to be under the rulership of Gedaliah ben Achikam. And we know that 11 years after the initial cries of Rachel Imenu, saying that the bourgeoisie of society, the aristocrats, the Kohanim, they're all going to return, v'shavu banim legvulam, we hear of a horrific story of Sinat Chinam, again, Rachel's children. And this time, Gedaliah ben Achikam, the governor of the Jews remaining in Eretz Yisrael, who is meant to lead them and already establish an infrastructure for return, he's assassinated by his own, by Yishmael ben Netanyah, by a nationalist. And we find that Yochanan ben Kereach, who is pro-Egyptian at the time, Yochanan ben Kereach leads the people. And he says, the Babylonians are definitely going to seek revenge. We have to go all the way down to Mitzrayim. But on his way down to Mitzrayim, where does he bring them? Vayechu vayeshvu begarut kimham asher itzel beit lechem. They come once again to Kever Rachel. And they turn to Yirmiyahu and they say, Yirmiyahu, you pray now for to Rachel Imenu, you pray, and we're sure that you're going to give us a similar message, that it's going to be a similar message of, we're going to have to go into Galut, but one day we're going to come back. And you know what Yirmiyahu comes back and tells them? Here in Kever Rachel, he says, Hashem tells you that now is the time. He incorporates the exact same terminology of 10 chapters earlier. He says, Im shov teshvu ba'aretz azot uvaniti etchem v'lo eheros. This time, if you stay in Eretz Yisrael, if you show the same tenacity as Rachel Imenu, then Hashem will not destroy you. Stay here right now. And he incorporates the same terminology. Ve'etein lachem rachamim v'richam etchem v'eshiv etchem al admatchem. The nevuah of Rachel Imenu will already come true. If you only display that steadfast nature and stay in Eretz Yisrael, Hashem will allow you to prepare the infrastructure for return. But the people don't believe Yirmiyahu. They say, no, sheker ata midaber. No, it must be that you're lying. Hashem didn't give you this message. It can't be that now is the time to already stay and return to the land of Israel. And unfortunately, as we know, they go down to Mitzrayim, where in the end, they're going to be completely annihilated by the Babylonians. And the Maharal therefore says, that's Rachel. Rachel, whose kever we saw, Rachel is buried baderech, because she represents for all of us, as Annie beautifully expressed, not only the empathetic role, not only the ideal shepherdess. Rachel represents what Mother's Day is all about. Rachel represents what commitment is all about. Rachel represents what investment is all about, because Rachel is everyone's mother. Rachel represents what it means never to leave us, never to stop crying. She's the koach ha-mekabetz v'ha-ma'ached otam. She's the one who unifies all of us. And she cries just as much for Shevet Yehuda, for the children of Leah. She cries for her own children. I'd like to share with you two beautiful stories of a more contemporary nature that teach us a little bit of the maternal nature of Rachel Imenu and what she represents for generations to come. This story is told by Max Nordau, one of the leading Zionists during the time of the first Zionist Congress, basically heralding the beginnings, as we know, of the return to Eretz Yisrael. The eminent scholar Avram Shalom Yehuda writes in his autobiographical work, Ever Arav, translated When I Study Rashi, Yehuda writes the following of the secular Zionist leader Max Nordau. On the second night of the first Zionist Congress in Basel, Nordau spoke in German, giving a long speech. He mentioned several times the motto, these words, quoting Hashem's response to Rachel Imenu, Vishavu Banim Legvulam, our children have returned to their borders. When asked by a young representative at the Congress how he found this verse in Yirmiyahu, and especially why he's quoting it in Hebrew, for this did not fit Nordau's educational background, definitely not his secular nature, Nordau replied, I know these words from the person to whom I am obliged, all my Judaism and Zionism, a person whose name I don't even know, a person who was in essence only a little boy of 8 or 10, and this is what happened. And he shared the following story. I have a children's clinic in Paris. He was a pediatrician. A woman, an immigrant from Poland, her hair covered with a scarf, came in with a pale boy, 8 or 10, sick for 3 weeks. Someone recommended that she bring him to me. I took out a form for a new patient and tried to speak to him in our local language, but he could hardly understand French. I asked his mother, who was also very poor at French, and she said, no, he doesn't go to a regular school. He goes to a cheder, a Jewish religious school. I scolded her harshly. This only causes anti-Semitism. We have opened the door for you, the gates to the country, to refugees from Poland. Why doesn't your child learn the national language here? She apologized and said that he's still young and that her husband is from the old generation, but he will go. He will study in the gymnasium and will learn the language. In anger, I asked the child, in cheder, what did you learn? His eyes lit up, and in Yiddish, which I understood because of my German, he told me what he had last studied in cheder. Yaakov, he said, was dying, and he invited Yosef and commanded him, swearing him, pleaded before him, please don't bury me in Egypt. There is Ma'arat HaMachpelah, where Avram, Yitzchak, Yaakov, Sarah, Rebecca, and there I bury Leah. Take me from Egypt and bury me with them. And when I came from Padan, Rachel died in the land of Canaan on the way to Ephrat, and I buried her there on the way in Beit Lechem. Why, in the middle of Yaakov's request, does he tell the story of Keva Rachel? Rashi says, and this is all the child talks about, 8 or 10 years old, speaking about the sages, that Yaakov, explained Chazal, felt a necessity to apologize to Yosef and say, I bother you like this, to take me from Egypt to Hebron, and I myself didn't bother to take your mother Rachel, and despite that, I was very close. Next to Beit Lechem, she was almost there, I took her, but even into the city, I didn't take her. I buried her on the way, but I'm not guilty, and I didn't act wrongly, Yosef, because God wanted it this way. He knew that one day the murderer Nebuchadnezzar would in the future exile the sons of Rachel, her sons, during the time of the first destruction. And then she would leave her grave and weep and wail her voice so that her voice would be heard. Rachel mevaka al baneha. But the Lord responds to her, Mini kolech mibechi veinaych midima, ki yeh sachar lefulatech. There is a reward for your actions, for your mesirut nefesh, then and now, Rachel. There's hope for the future, and the children will return to their borders. Vishavu banim levu. And I, says Dr. Max Nordo, I didn't know what to do with myself. I turned to the window so that the mother and child wouldn't see the tears rolling down my cheeks. And I said to myself, Max, aren't you ashamed for yourself? You're an educated man, known as an intellectual with a doctor's degree, but you don't know anything about the history of your people. From all the holy scriptures, nothing. And here, the sick child, weak, an immigrant, a refugee, he speaks of Yaakov, Yosef, Yirmiyahu, and Rachel. He speaks of his fathers and his mother as if it was yesterday. It all lives in front of his eyes. I wiped the tears from my cheeks and I turned to them and I said in my heart, a people with children like this that actually live their past, they will have a sparkling future. In the weekend newspaper, I saw an advertisement. Whoever believes that the fate of the Jewish people is important to them, please call to help find an answer. Dr. Theodore Herzl. I called immediately. When we founded the Zionist Congress for the first one, when I was honored to speak and give a speech, the figure of that little boy, whose name I don't even remember, stood in front of my eyes. But those words I will never forget, because they are the foundation of Zionism. They are the pillars of Judaism, Vishavu Banim Legvulam, and the children will return to their borders. What greater mother do we have than Rachel Imenu, crying with us and for us, encouraging us through generations to return to Eretz Yisrael, and not just to Eretz Yisrael, but she's the mother of Binyamin, the mother of Binyamin, to whom Hashem promises, Yishkon lavetach, alav chofef, chofef alav kol hayom uven ktefav shachen. Hashem will always reside between the mountain ranges of Binyamin. The Shekhinah will always reside in Yerushalayim. Rachel Imenu is the mother then of Yerushalayim, the mother of return. And this story is also told, as Rivi mentioned as well, Chaim Silverstein from Arut Sheva told how we have Kava Rachel today, despite the Oslo agreements. During the Rabin administration, Rachel's tomb was slated to fall into Area A under Arab civil and military control. Upon seeing this, Knesset member Hanan Porat from Kfar Etzion, Zichrono Lebracha, decided that he must speak with Rabin in the hope of changing his mind. And as Porat was walking to Rabin's office, Knesset member Rabbi Menachem Parush asked him where he was going, and hearing that Porat was about to fight for Kava Rachel, Parush asked to join in the meeting. Anna, when they were there, Rabin's office, Porat, was diligently explaining the ins and the outs of the security situation at the tomb and making rational arguments that did not seem to move Rabin. Suddenly, Yitzhak Rabin looked at Parush and saw that he was crying. Parush held Rabin's hands, and with tears streaming down his face, he said, "Yitzhak, it's Mama Rachel, Mama Rachel." At that moment, Rabin's heart opened, and he altered the map so that Rachel's kever would remain in Jewish hands, so that she could continue to cry for us and with us, so that Nava Applebaum, Kena, just like her mother Rachel, continue to cry on her wedding day of all the dreams yet to be fulfilled, of all the prophecies yet to materialize. And just as Dr. Ariella Agatstein told us, that same seeing the future, anticipating the future, exemplified by another Rachel, by another mother, Rachel Eshet Rabbi Akiva, who was able to see the potential for him becoming a tremendous Talmid Chacham, willing to sacrifice all the wealth of her father's home so that Rabbi Akiva could sit in Yavne by Rabbi Yoshua, by Rabbi Eliezer ben Hurkonos, the Gedolei Hador in Yavne, and raise 12,000 students, only to come back and say, yes, he can go another 12 years and focus there on his learning. And he comes back with 24,000 students. And yes, it's Rachel, who when they were first married is willing to forfeit it all and to sit in straw and sleep in the hay. And in the morning, Rabbi Akiva would be Malakei Teven Mitoch Saroteha. And Rabbi Akiva, when he looks at Rachel's hair, and Rachel's hair in particular, we're gonna see, he doesn't just see hair. He sees the Sefer Torah. He sees her commitment to every single letter. And that's why he says, I can already see the crown of Yerushalayim Shel Zahav. I see the commitment of Torah together with the commitment to Yerushalayim. I see the crown, that gorgeous golden tiara called Yerushalayim Shel Zahav. And one day I'm going to put that crown of gold. I'm going to put Jerusalem of gold upon your head. And sure enough, we know that one day he does, as she comes after 24 years, when he finally returns from Yavne to Bnei Brak. And in fact, she reaches him and kisses his feet, and no one recognizes her and shoos her away. And Rabbi Akiva says, what do you mean? Sheli v'shalachem shelahi. My Torah and your Torah is all because of her commitment to Torah. That's what Rachel represents. Al yadahu kol ma shelamadati, everything that I've learned. It's because of her commitment. It's because that Rabbi Akiva has such a wife, which is why in Masechet Shabbat, when we hear about this gorgeous tiara with Yerushalayim engraved in gold upon it, we hear that, and in fact, Rabbi Akiva did fashion this for his wife, and Rabban Gamliel, the Nasi, even his wife turns and says, you know, I'm the Nasi's wife. You know, can't you get me an ear shel zahav? Can't you buy me such a golden tiara? And he says, the reason why Rachel, Ishet Rabbi Akiva, has it is because she would cut off the braids of her hair so that Rabbi Akiva can go and learn Torah. She cut off her hair. She cut off her own letters, as we're going to see, so that Rabbi Akiva can learn the letters of the Torah, so that he can one day place crowns on the letters of the Torah. She deserves those crowns. And how do we know that her hair is in fact like the letters of the Torah? Well, we take the most beautiful story, the one that Rabbi Akiva loves and lives, Shir HaShirim HaKodesh Kodashim, wherein the dod, the male persona, is, as we know in allegorical terms, compared to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And what does God look like, the manifestation of this beloved? Dodi tzach va'adom, he's clear and ruddy. Dagul mirvava, he's a banner amongst tens of thousands. He stands out. Rosho ketempaz, his head has a golden crown. Kavutzotav taltalim shchorot ko'orev, and he has black curls, black like a raven. Chazal explain, what are these black curls? Melamed sheyesh lidrosh al kol kotz v'kotz tilei tilim shel halachot. These are the curls of the letters of the Sefer Torah, the black ink of the Sefer Torah. HaKadosh Baruch Hu manifests himself through the letters of the Torah. And as we know, the famous story in Menachot, Moshe Rabbeinu is ready to accept the Torah, but God isn't ready to give it because he's busy tying crowns to those letters. He's busy putting on those golden crowns on his black curls of the Sefer Torah. And Moshe Rabbeinu says, really, Mima Keval Yadacha, why do you need these? Who's holding you back? And Hashem says, one day, Akiva ben Yosef is going to explain every little curl, every little kotz bekotz, tilin betilin shel halachot. He's going to understand the crowns. He's going to understand between the lines. He's going to understand every nuance on the letter. And Moshe Rabbeinu says, show him to me. And he shows, and sure enough, Moshe Rabbeinu doesn't understand all these different nuances until Rabbi Akiva says, halacha l'Moshe Misinai, until Moshe Rabbeinu realizes that Rabbi Akiva is continuing the Mesorah of the giving of the Torah that started with Moshe Rabbeinu, but in his very creative way, is going to extrapolate so many different halachot from every nuance, every kotz, every little corner of a yud, every little curl of the Torah. And sure enough, Moshe Rabbeinu is also going to see how Rabbi Akiva suffers for this. Rabbi Akiva's tremendous commitment and love as he dies with Shema Yisrael Hashem Elokeinu Hashem Echad. And therefore, Rabbi Akiva is known as Hadoresh Kitrei Otiyot, Umagale Panim BaTorah. Through his wife's hair, he understands the letters of the Torah. Through the commitment displayed, he is able to learn and to raise an entire generation to continue the Mesorah. And Eliyahu HaNavi takes him to sit in the Yeshiva Shalmala, Lidrosh Bekitrei Otiyot. Rachel, though, is not only representative of the commitment to Torah, that she basically, through with that commitment, perpetuated the Torah from Moshe Rabbeinu, throughout the time periods of the destruction of the Beit HaMikdash, so that we today can have at the halachot, the midrashei halachot of Rabbi Akiva, that by wearing that Yerushalayim Shel Zahav, she links us to the city. She's not just representative of commitment to Torah, but what commitment to Yerushalayim is all about. And this I heard from none other than Yekirat Yerushalayim from Rabbanit Malkabina, who were based on this Mishnah Masechet Shabbat, where we find that Chazal teach us that a woman should not go out on Shabbat with that beautiful tiara, Yerushalayim Shel Zahav, with the golden crown. Lo b'ir shel sahav. And what is this? This golden crown. In fact, this is a golden crown, b'ir shel sahav, that Chazal teach us. Yes, Yerushalayim shel sahav, kida'avid le Rabbi Akiva lebeitu, like the one that Rabbi Akiva made for his wife Rachel, because she so represented what this ir shel sahav was about. But Rabbi Akiva disagreed with the other chachamim, and he agreed with Rabbi Eliezer, who said, no, you're allowed to walk out with this crown on Shabbat. A woman is allowed to walk out. And Chazal asks, well, what's the machloket? Rabbi Meir believes that a woman is not allowed to walk out with this golden tiara on Shabbat because it's a burden. And therefore, she's going to remove it. And then she'll transgress the melacha of carrying on Shabbat. But the Chachamim disagree and say, no. Gana, it's an ornament. So why can't you go out with it? Gana, we're just afraid you're going to remove it. You're going to show it off to people. And therefore, you don't necessarily are going to definitely override the malacha, but you shouldn't. L'chatchila, a priori, you shouldn't walk out with this golden ornament on Shabbat. But Rabbi Eliezer and Rabbi Akiva hold that an important woman, someone like Rachel, Eshet Rabbi Akiva, no, we're not concerned about her because she understands what a significant ornament it is, what a badge of honor it is. She's not going to show it off to others. She's going to keep it on her head. And therefore, we're not afraid of her taking it off on Shabbat. And what does this basically mean? Rabbanit Bina says, these are three different approaches to one's commitment to Yerushalayim. Some people consider Yerushalayim a burden. Oh no, there are riots going on. Ramadan, first opportunity, we can take it off. First opportunity, we can literally absolve ourselves of the burden of Yerushalayim, we'll take it off. And the Chachamim say, no, some people don't view it as a burden, but really something to show off one's connection to Yerushalayim. And really Yerushalayim is just about what they can say. Oh yes, I stayed in this hotel in Yerushalayim. But Rabbi Eliezer and Rabbi Akiva know that Rachel, Eshet Rabbi Akiva, teaches us. She's a mother who understands Yerushalayim. It's an important woman who knows that It's our badge of honor. This is our identity. We keep it on our heads, in our heads, and in our hearts at all times. Such a woman will never take Yerushalayim out of her heart or off of her head. This is going to be worn forever and ever. And therefore, we know that at the time of the Korban, women stopped wearing this beautiful crown that they would wear on their wedding days. They no longer wear the crown of Yerushalayim. And instead, what do we wear instead of the crown of Yerushalayim? We remember, even al ros simchati, we're going to put the efer tachat pe'er. We put the ashes instead, in order to remember that we don't have that golden tiara, but we still have to keep Yerushalayim on our head, in our heads, and in our hearts. That's Rachel Eshet Rabbi Akiva. And as Rivi beautifully introduced us to Rachel HaMishoreret, so inspired as she grew up in her father, the rabbi of Kiev's home, so inspired by the words of Tanakh, so inspired by Rachel Eshet Rabbi Akiva, but also Rachel Imenu, she herself who can write about what it means to be barren, barren of child like Rachel Imenu, until the birth of Yosef, barren of our city, like Rachel who cries, Me'ana lihinachem al banah ki'enenu. Barren now, as all of us are, without the beautiful crown of Yerushalayim, of Rachel Eshet Rabbi Akiva. She says, oh, if I had a son, a little son, with black curled hair, like the hair of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, and clever eyes, a little son to walk with in the garden under morning skies, a son, a little son. I'd call him Uri, little laughing Uri. Like Uri, Uri, says Yeshayahu, ki ba orech, the call of Yerushalayim to life. I would name her a tender name, as light as Yerushalayim, as full of joy, as sunlight on the dew, as tripping on the tongue, as the laughter of a boy. Uri, I'd call him. And still I wait, as Mother Rachel waited, or Hannah at Shiloh, she the barren one, until the day comes when my lips whisper, Uri, my son. Perhaps Uri, Uri, kiba orech, that the time now has come, says Rachel HaMishoreret, to welcome our son. As Rabbanit Bina began, time for Yerushalayim to become that mother. Beautifully described by HaMishoreret Rachel. And now we turn to our mother's Naomi, as we're anticipating, in just a week from now, exactly a week from now, we're going to read the story of Ruth, the Ima Shel Malchut. But the story is actually not about Ruth. She's the best supporting actress in Jewish history. But the story is actually about Naomi, as we find from the exposition. It's about Naomi and Naomi's family, and Naomi who remains barren and desolate. Naomi who loses her husband and her homeland and her two sons. Naomi who really could and should wallow in depression. And yet, what does she do? Vatakomhi, she gets up and she's going to change her trajectory. Vatashav, she is going to change the Mila Mancha. Instead of it just being about the names of her husband and her children that are no longer, she's going to return. She returns Miste Moav. And why? She doesn't just want to return to her homeland. Naomi represents for us what it means to return after years of drought and famine, after a rift between us and God. Because Naomi doesn't just want to return from Sde Moab. She realizes that Hashem has given us lechem. She realizes that the years of famine are gone. She realizes that now there's a relationship manifest once more in the land of Israel. And she wants to be part of that relationship with God. And therefore, she goes Lashuv el Eretz Yehuda. And therefore, she turns to Ruth and to Orpah. She says, Shovna benotai, it's not returning for you. You should return to your homelands, to your initial identity. I'm returning to mine. Again, I'm returning to my relationship with God. The Mila Mancha mentioned no less than 12 times is Zavatashav Tshuva. Naomi teaches us what it means to return to Beit Lechem, to return to that same area of Rachel Imenu, to return directly south of Yerushalayim, to follow that call of Rachel that she herself has not even heard yet, that call of Vishavu Banim Lugvulam, she returns. And because she returns her Tshuva, we know that she ends up having a meshiv nefesh. She's not only merits returning to God and returning to the land, she merits geula through root. She merits long-term perpetuating of a name the name of Rachel and Leah, as Annie spoke about, the names of her husband and her children, the names of her tribe that will forever be present in the land of Israel. And therefore, Rabbi Zeira explains, you want to know the whole theme of Megillat Ruth. It's about kama sachar tov legomlei chasadim, that when you perform an act, you don't even know the ramifications. The tshuva of Naomi leads to, ultimately, not only the return of her, not only the perpetuation of her name, but ultimately the establishment of Beit David. But it doesn't come on its own. Naomi teaches us that you can't just sit passively and cry. There has to be a pu'ula like Rachel Imenu. You have to get up despite the exile, despite difficult times, despite oppression. She teaches us how to surmount the challenges, the obstacles, the losses in our lives. She teaches us what happens when mothers lose children. You get up and you rebuild your families and you keep the names alive and you speak about them. And you establish your children and your grandchildren, as we heard Miriam Peretz speaking to all the children of the victims of Meron, Gana, the terrible, terrible tragedies, all those children who will go on to live, but not in a passive way. Chazal teach us, Hashem said, Ruth got up and did something. Boaz got up and did something. Naomi asta chala. When Hashem sees that we're going to actively return, when Hashem sees both the persistence, but also the hope in the future of the mothers, and not just passive hope, but active hope, Amar HaKadosh Baruch Hu, Afani, Ese Echeli. Look at these amazing matriarchs. Now what can I do? I now have to facilitate their return. I have to ensure geula, v'shavu banim l'gvulam. And as Rivi beautifully ended with Naomi Shemer, Naomi, the mother who brings all these mothers together, she describes how in the winter of 1967, she was approached by Gil Adlema of Kol Yisrael, and Teddy Kalak, who was the mayor of Yerushalayim, asked different singers to commission songs about Yerushalayim. And at that point, again, these songs would always be going to be composed in honor of Yom HaTzma'ut, generally on radio. But in that same year, 1967, on a one-time basis, they commissioned songs from five professional composers, Naomi Shemer being among them. And she said, I found it very difficult to write a song until I remembered the legend of Rabbi Akiva promising his wife, Rachel, a city of gold, a piece of gold jewelry depicting Yerushalayim. And I chose Shuli Natan to perform the song. And I remember the commitments of mothers. I remember the commitments to Yerushalayim. And yes, in fact, I composed the song Yerushalayim Shel Zahav. The song was a hit from the very first performance. And at midnight, when Shuli was asked to return to the stage, the audience was already singing along with the chorus. And what's remarkable is that what does she sing about? Again, as she sings about Yerushalayim Shel Zahav, we just heard the beautiful rendition of Sholom. We hear about The sleeping Ilan Ve'Eben, the trees and the stones that sleep like Choni HaMa'agel, waiting Shvuya B'Chaloma, waiting Shir HaMalo B'Shub Hashem Shivat Zion Hayina Kochomim, waiting to return, waiting to see the fulfillment of all those prophecies that Rabbi Akiva spoke about, waiting for the prophecy to Rachel Imenu, to the vision of Rachel Eshet Rabbi Akiva, the initiative of Naomi, all the mothers to come and bring Yerushalayim back to the glory of Yerushalayim Shel Zahav, V'Shel Nechoshet, V'Shel Or, to that Ori, Ori that Rachel HaMeshareret spoke about, to bring back, as she describes beautifully, again, how I long, she says, not only to return to the Ma'arot, to the caves, and not only to go back to the areas of Yam HaMelech and Yericho, but she says, again, I come to sing V'lach L'kshor K'tarim, to place those beautiful tiara of Yerushalayim, the glory of Yerushalayim, the commitment of Yerushalayim, to place each and every one of the mothers of Am Yisrael, each of you for Mother's Day, I wish upon you, Yerushalayim Shel Zahav, that you should celebrate the commitment to Yerushalayim, never to take it off of your head, to be able to walk out even on Shabbat with this beautiful keter of Yerushalayim Shel Zahav. And sure enough, she who says, I am the katon of the tzair, who am I to write a song of Yerushalayim? Even though Rav Shmuel Hanagid says that you can be a poet and write 5,000 songs, but if you didn't write a song of Yerushalayim, then you're not a poet. But if you write one song, and I believe even if you can sing one song of Yerushalayim, then you're a poet. then you've understood the cries of Rachel Imenu and Rachel Ishet Rabbi Akiva and Rachel HaMishoreret. Then you understand the tshuva of Naomi and the inspiration of Naomi Shemer HaMishoreret. Then you understand how miraculous it was, how just a few weeks before the Six-Day War, before what we celebrate on Yom Yerushalayim, this mother of ours, composed the song of the mothers, Rachel Imenu, Rachel Eshet Rabbi Akiva. And that song that the paratroopers tell her is playing over and over again. Genohua, take a look at this beautiful handwritten letter written on June 6, 1967 by a pilot who explains how Yerushalayim Shel Zahav has become, he says, just part of the regular song, the regular conversation. This is what the entire chevra, he says, lo mapsikim lashir, we don't stop singing this. And you wouldn't believe this, that this is the song that's inspiring us during these days. During these days, as we are fighting and struggling all the way up north, he says, and we're also winning. He says, you're never going to believe this. I'm writing in the name of all those up in the north right now. Thank you. Thank you, Mother Naomi, for this beautiful song of inspiration, because right now, mamash berega zeh, mitoseinu matgizim et harama, right now we're attacking Ramat HaGolan. Right now, we know, during this same time, the paratroopers of the Harel Brigade were coming into the Lion's Gate to reclaim and reunify Yerushalayim, v'shirech, and your song, Yerushalayim Shel Zahav, is being heard on the radio. That's when we know that Naomi Shemer took a little piece of paper, a little napkin, and she composed the last two paragraphs, the last two stanzas of Yerushalayim Shel Zahav. At first she said, Echa Yashvu, how Yerushalayim sits with all of its empty borot. Well, then she wrote, Chazarnu al borot hamayim lashuk v'lakikar. Shofar kore bahar habayit bi'ir ha'atika. But then we heard the shofar of Rav Gorin. Ovim ma'arot asher pasala, alfei shmashot zorchot, nashuv neved al yam hamelech, v'derech yericho. Yerushalayim Shel Zahav, on this Mother's Day, may we seek the inspiration of Rachel Imenu, who consoles us to know that one day not only we will return, but Baruch Hashem, we celebrate today that we have returned, b'shavu banim l'gvulam. We celebrate the mother Rachel, Eshet Rabbi Akiva, who is able to see with optimism the crowns and hairs, who is able to support the commitment to Torah, and thereby deserves the beautiful Yerushalayim to never leave her head. And we celebrate Rachel HaMishoreret, and Naomi HaMishoreret, and Naomi who taught us the power of return. May we continue to seek the inspiration, the hope, the optimism, and the beautiful comforting words of our five mothers of the past who inspire us for the present, who remind us on Mother's Day how we can instill in our children and our little children in Cheder to remember the stories of how Yaakov was able to see the power of Rachel Imenu and all the mothers since then, to cry for her children. And may we, this Mother's Day, cry both at the tears to continue longing and yearning for the return, the full return of the Shechina to Yerushalayim. But in the meantime, cry the tears of laughter. Shir hama'alot b'shuv Hashem et shivat Zion hayinu kochomim, az yemalei schok pinu oshoneinu bina. Wishing all of you magnificent mothers of the past and the present and the future, a Yom Yerushalayim Sameach. Thank you all for joining.
Shani?
Yes, Rabbanit Bina.
Amazing. Last week was beautiful. This was Mashu Miuchad, and putting in Naomi Shemer and the Mishoreret Rachel. and kind of connecting everything together, it makes a harmony in Am Yisrael. It's very, very special, very beautiful. Max Nordo, everybody made it. It was really along with Yirmiyahu and beautiful, beautiful. Toda, toda, mikol halev, beautiful words. Thank you everyone for joining. Shani, mitzia.
Thank you, thank you. And thank you, our mentor mother, Yekirat Yerushalayim. And I guess it was also the power of Mother's Day that inspires us, particularly as mothers, to reconnect to Yerushalayim. And we celebrate with Yerushalayim. Thank you.
Thank you to everyone. You. Yom Yerushalayim Sameach.
Beautiful.
Thanks, Mommy.
You're welcome.
The greatest inspiration is a mother.
Mm-hmm.